Hello, comrades, and welcome back to Ushanka Show. Здравствуйте, дорогие товарищи. В эфире программа Ushanka Show. My name is Sergey, and almost 50 years ago, in July of 1971, I was born in the USSR. Меня зовут Сергей, и 50 лет тому назад я родился в Советском Союзе.
Problem is that this guy has very little knowledge about the USSR. He is so dumb that sometimes he cannot distinguish between shortcomings of the Ukrainian Soviet Republic and simply technology of the time. When he left his home country, he was barely old enough to understand dynamics of the society he lived in.
Recently, one of my viewers asked about Soviet dachas, so that's what we're going to talk today. The topic of the video is Soviet dacha lifestyle. If you don't know what dacha is, no worries. We have a lesson of the Russian language. Урок русского языка. Дача. Дача. Дача – это загородный дом с приусадебным участком. What? That's what I said. Дача – это загородный дом с приусадебным участком. So, загородный дом с приусадебным участком could be translated as a house on the outside of the city with the garden lot attached. But of course, as it quite often happens, it's a little bit more complicated than that. It's not just a house on the outskirts of the city. When I looked at this topic, I kind of come up with the conclusion that there are three types of dacha. Number one, государственная дача. So this is government dacha, but you can't really call it dacha. It's actually like more like government-provided estate. So for the leaders of the Communist Party, leaders of the Soviet Union, apparatchiks, nomenklatura, generals, high officials, maybe famous actors, book writers, government will provide them with dacha, but there'll be a nice size house in some nice location. They said it would be more like a state. For example, our dear leader, Comrade Stalin, had 20 different state dachas, state estates, located in very nice areas around Moscow, Abkhazia, Crimea. So he had quite nice places. Comrade Nikita Khrushchev, after he was forcefully retired, spent the rest of his days at his dacha, which was also state estate, and that's where he dictated his famous memoirs about his experience in being in the Soviet government. The other type of dacha was so-called dachny uchastok. So this is pretty much like a garden lot. You weren't really allowed to build a building there. You might just set up some kind of temporary shed or later shipping container to store your stuff, and that will be just a small lot for people to grow crops, usually potatoes. Дачный участок. But still, if you go there, they say he went on поехал на дачу, but it doesn't mean he has actual dacha, like a house. Maybe he just went to work on his дачный участок, on his garden lot. And then of course we had real dacha, which is загородный дом с приусадебным участком. So it's a small house on a small lot somewhere out in the country. And when I say small, it is pretty small. We usually used so-called сотка as a measurement of area. So we use hectares, right? And a hectare is a 100 meters by 100 meters. So 10,000 square meters is one hectare. Сотка, it's 1/100th of that. So people were allowed to have 6 сотkas, which is approximately 28 meters long and 21 meters wide lot. In feet will be about 90 feet long and 69 feet wide. That was a standard size for the dacha lot, 6 соток, 6 сотkas. The Soviet dacha movement, as we know it, began back in February of 1949 when Soviet Minister of SSR, so the main government body of the Soviet Union, issued a decree about collective and individual gardening and orchard maintaining, owning by workers and white-collar people. This degree on its own deserves a separate video. I need to actually study it more, because it's so bizarre that Comrade Stalin, I mean, we're talking 1949, so Stalin still at power, allowed workers and other city people to have a lot, not big, but still a plot of land when they can plant, and it actually talks a lot about potatoes and plant orchards, and they were allowed to do it for 5 years. So you have a lot free of charge, but of course you don't own it, you just have the right to cultivate it, and you can do it for 5 years. To me, it almost looks like admission that collective farms failed to provide plenty of foodstuffs for the cities. So now government decided, okay, if we cannot feed the cities, let cities feed themselves. Let provide them with this pretty small plots of land and allow them to plant potatoes and other crops so they can feed their own families. Fun fact, originally there were no housing was allowed on those plots, only like a little shed to keep your tools. But later on, it was allowed to have a small, as we call, dacha, so this little summer home. But there were rules: you couldn't have a basement and you couldn't have a second floor. So it should be just a small summer home, dacha, and no basement, no second floor. By the way, Soviet government workers, apparatchiks in the nomenklatura, also had limits how big their dachas could be. The law of 1938 limited that government dacha shouldn't have more than 8 rooms if you are married, or only 5 rooms if you're a single apparatchik. And the size of the lot was 100 sotkas. So regular worker was getting 6 sotkas, which is basically 0.15 acre. While Soviet officials were allowed to have 100 sotka, which is 2.5 acres. So some comrades were more equal than other comrades. To become a dacha owner was kind of cumbersome. You couldn't just go out in the village and ask for a lot of land. And you're supposed to join a cooperative. So you'll be like a member of a dachny cooperative. And they would be looking, talking to collective farms, find some suitable land. And then they will occupy that land, and they split it in small lots, those 6 sotka lots, and then you'll get one of those lots. Since most Soviet people didn't own the car, usually the dacha areas sprung around railroad stations. So out in the country, you know, we had like urban trains, electric trains called elektrichka. So all those small train stations, that's where the people will be getting dacha lots, because that will be a convenient way to get out on the weekend. And also a convenient way to bring your crops back to the city, because bringing sacks of potatoes on the bus is not as easy as doing the same thing on a train. It's way more room, you can fit your tools easy, and also big sacks of potatoes and whatever else you're bringing home. Curiously enough, when Khrushchev replaced Stalin, he actually stopped allowing people having dacha lots. He didn't confiscate the ones that people already had, but he stopped letting new lots being developed. And I find it really curious, because I think he considered that collective farms can provide plenty of food for all the Soviet people. There is no need for this revisionism, pretty much, and letting Soviet people individually grow their own crops. Then, of course, when Brezhnev replaced Khrushchev, he once again in 1965 allowed dacha movement. Yay! And later on in 1987, Comrade Gorbachev removed limits how large your dacha building could be. So now the summer homes could be 2-story high, could have basement, whatever. So this is kind of interesting evolution of the dacha laws, beginning from Stalin in 1947 and moving along in 1949, I apologize, and then being stopped by Khrushchev, restarted again by Brezhnev, and then no more limits under Gorbachev. So Dacha movement in the Soviet Union was quite popular. By 1986, close to 6.6 million workers were cultivating 426,000 hectares and having them, of course, under dachas. That's over 1 million acres was cultivated and had dachas built on it. So Dacha in Soviet Union had quite a few different purposes. First of all, it was a plot of land where you can grow your crops. Then secondly, it was a summer home where you can spend weekends and even vacation. If you had nowhere to go, you have your staycation, or we'll call it dachacation. Some families, due to housing shortage, we had situation when kids growing up had their own families, but grandparents still live in the same apartment. So dacha was a really nice way of grandparents to spend the summer out in a dacha. They will be taking care of the garden and living in that summer home while giving children more room. And then in September, October, when the weather gets colder, then grandparents move back into the city. And then next spring, the same kind of extended vacation starts again. Another thing you need to know about dachas, most people who wanted to have a dacha were real city folk. What I mean, like maybe third, fourth generation city people. So never, they didn't have relatives out in the country. For example, my parents came from the villages, so we had no reason to have a dacha because we could get our potatoes and everything else from the lots of my grandparents, either on mother or my father's side. So every spring, my family went up north to help my grandparents to plant potatoes around May holidays, so between May 1st, May 9th. And then in the fall, it was my father's job to get some kind of vehicle to go up north and bring potatoes home. Same kind of as his village, but he had so many other brothers and sisters, it was not enough potatoes to share between nine children. So most of our potatoes came from my mother's side. After my grandparents passed away in the early 80s, one time my mother was considering getting a dacha lot along with her other co-workers through her place of work. But that collective farm that we had agreement about using some of their land, they offered really bad location. It was like up on a really steep hill, and my mom looked, said it'll be just nightmare to grow potatoes there. So we refused, and we never got that lot. A little bit later, I believe that was maybe early 90s, middle 90s, because I wasn't a part of that project. But one of my cousins offered my mother to use her lot. So they got a second lot in a nice location by the Dnieper River. And they had another lot. She said, Lena, I have no use for it. If you want to plant potatoes, go ahead. So my mom tried. But she said, first of all, it was a long walk, about close to 4 or 5 kilometers from the train station to get to the plot. And then they just had issues because locals were stealing their crops. Remember that story about growing up in the Soviet ghetto? So yeah, there'll be, you know, potatoes growing and no one around to guard them. So locals, they will grab, mostly probably not potatoes, like if any ripe tomatoes or cucumbers they'll see, they'll just come and pick them up because those city people far away anyways. So she tried that lot for several years and then she gave up on it. So as I said, our family never actually had a dacha. We used our village home as a summer home for many years until it went to complete disrepair. Well, comrades, that's all I have for you today. I hope you enjoyed this story and learned something new. As always, your questions and comments are welcome. Don't forget to like this video, and we'll talk to you soon. До свидания. Goodbye.
store at cheesegrain.com.
Just a friendly reminder that my book American Diaries is available on Amazon.com, or shoot me an email if you would like to have a signed copy. Thank you.
And if you love my channel and would like to show your support, please click on the link below this video and become the patron of the Ushanka Show. For as little as $1, you can help us grow and create the new interesting videos about the life and